In this video, we set up the integral for the surface area of the ellipsoid found by revolving this curve, x over 3 quantity squared plus y over 2 quantity squared equals 1, about the x-axis. Once the integral is set up, it turns out that it can actually be calculated in exact form by using a trigonometric substitution, so we're going to take it all the way through that calculation in this video. At the very end, I'm going to verify my symbolic solution by checking with a computer algebra system. Now, if you haven't seen trigonometric substitutions yet in your calculus class, just look at the chapters down in the description and you can skip ahead to the end of the video where I verify my symbolic solution by using a computer algebra system. So to find a surface area of revolution, we slice into these thin ribbons, and I have this red ribbon already in the picture. And the thickness is given by a little arc length element that we usually call ds. And ds is given by 1 plus the derivative of that curve squared dx. And the radius of the ribbon, well, that's just the height of the function at this arbitrary location x. So the y value corresponding to some arbitrary x. Now, before we can flesh out these expressions, I've got to solve for y in the original equation of this ellipse. So I'm going to start there and say y over 2 squared equals 1 minus x over 3 squared, which I'll write as x squared over 9. Then I square root both sides and multiply by 2 to solve for y. So y is going to be 2 square root 1 minus x squared over 9. So that's the y that's going to go in here for the radius of the ribbon. But to get that little arc length element and ultimately the area contribution of this ribbon, I've got to get the first derivative of y. So when I differentiate this square root, well, square root is really a power of 1/2. So I have 1/2, 1 minus x squared over 9 to the negative 1/2. Then the chain rule says multiply by the derivative of the interior there, which is negative 2x over 9. Cleaning things up a little, I have negative 2x over 9 square root 1 minus x squared over 9. Now, I don't particularly like having fractions inside of fractions, so I'm going to take one factor of 3 from this 9 and distribute that into the interior of the square root, and it becomes a 9 in there. We get negative 2x over 3 times the square root of 9 minus x squared, and that's a little bit nicer. So I may as well just get y prime squared right here before I plug it into ds, and I get 4x squared over 9 times the quantity 9 minus x squared. Again, that was y prime squared. So now I can write down the area of this thin area contribution from the ribbon. And I have a little ds for the thickness. And then the length of this ribbon, well, that's the circumference of it from back when it was rolled up. And so that's going to be 2 pi times the radius, but the radius is y as a function of x. And normally I would call that little area contribution dA. So we have dA is equal to the area of this little thing. Well, it's just a rectangle, so length times width. 2 pi y of x times ds. So that's 2 pi. And then y of x is given by this expression. Times 2 root 1 minus x squared over 9 times ds, which is this enormous square root, 1 plus 4x squared over 9 times the quantity 9 minus x squared dx. And this is why it's surprising that it turns out this thing has an exact form solution. ds in practice is usually so ugly that there's no symbolic solution to these integrals. Well, this is one case where there is. I'm going to clean this up just a little bit before I slap an integral sign on it, and the integral will simply add up all the area contributions. So I have 4 pi, and then I can multiply the interiors of these two square roots and turn them into one single square root. Now I'm going to distribute a 3 into the interior of the square root, and the point of that is that it should clean up this piece, so that I recognize that it's really the same factor as this piece in this denominator. So I'm going to divide by 3 out in front, multiply by 3 inside the square root, which gives you a 9 in there. So I have 9 minus x squared times the quantity 1 plus 4x squared over 9 times 9 minus x squared d. dx. Now when I distribute the 9 minus x squared into this second piece inside the radical, it's going to cancel a factor in that second term. So I distributed it to the 1 out here in front. When I distribute it to that fraction, it just cancels the 9 minus x squared, and I'm left with a 4x squared over 9. I'll go ahead and put in an intermediate step here. X squared is just 9x squared over 9, so I'm just trying to get a common denominator with that second term. Now I don't particularly like the fraction inside of that square root, so I'm going to multiply by 3 inside the square root, which becomes a 9, and divide by 3 out in front. So I end up with 4 pi over 9, and inside I have 81 minus 5x squared. And now I recognize this as a trig substitution type of integral. So let me go ahead and finally apply the integral and say the total area is going to be the sum of all the area contributions. And I'm going to go ahead and just do the right side of the ellipsoid. So that's as x goes from 0 to 3, and then I'll double the answer. Just cleans things up to do it that way. And plug in dA. And now again, if you've never seen a trig substitution before, you might want to skip to the end of the video where we do this integral using a computer algebra system. If you want to see the trig substitution, then here we go. And the idea here is that we have inside of that square root something that could be simplified to the square of a single function, and then the square root would simplify. Now a constant minus the square of a function, that fits the form of a trig identity. So our goal is to fit this form. And I've got a couple annoying constants floating around. So here's how I'm going to do the substitution. When I square that x, what I'm trying to get is a factor of 81 to come out of here, so that I can factor the 81 out of the entire square root. So I'm going to let x be 9, so when I square it, I get 81, over root 5, so that when I square it, it cancels this factor of 5. And then the function piece that I want here is the sine function, so we'll put it in a sine theta. This means that x squared is 81 over 5 sine squared theta. And it also means that dx, which also has to be transformed here, is 9 over root 5 cosine theta d theta. Furthermore, I'd like to transform my limits of integration so I can forget about x for the rest of the problem. So I look at my substitution and I ask myself, when x is 0, that's the lower limit of integration down here. When x is 0, what is theta? Well, the sine of 0 is 0, so theta must be 0. What about when x is 3? It's not going to be so clean. When x is 3, I would have 3 equals 9 over root 5 sine theta. Cancel a factor of 3 here. And I end up with root 5 over 3 equals sine theta. So theta is the inverse sine of root 5 over 3. That becomes my new upper limit for the integral. So we transform the integral, and as I do this, I'm going to pull the constants out in front that were already there. There was a 4 pi over 9 to pull out, so this becomes 8 pi over 9 times the integral. As x goes from 0, well, that means theta was 0, to when x is 3, that means theta is the inverse sine of root 5 over 3 times the square root of 81 minus 5 times x squared, which I already determined is 81 over 5 sine squared theta, times dx, which we figured out was 9 over root 5 cosine theta d theta. Well, I can cancel a 9 here, so that's nice. And then I'll move that 1 over root 5 out in front for now. And then if I look at what's happening inside of the square root, these 5s are going to cancel. Each term has an 81 stuck to it, which we sort of arranged intentionally, and I factor an 81 out of the square root, which gives me a 9 out there, so I'm just going to put that in front of the integral. Now, inside that square root is a 1 minus sine squared. That's all that's left, and that's the trig identity we were trying to take advantage of. That's cosine squared, but the square root of that is just cosine. So all of this stuff is just going to reduce to cosine of theta. I have another one right here that came from transforming the differential dx. So I end up with the integral of cosine squared theta d theta. Now the first time you see that integral, it's pretty tricky. You have to use a trig identity for it. I'm going to go ahead and smash the 8 and the 9 out in front as I do this. So 72 pi over root 5. And the cosine squared has an identity. That's 1/2 1 plus cosine of twice the angle. I can cancel the 2 by bringing the 1/2 out in front, and I'm back to 36 pi out in front of this integral. And now each piece of the integral is guessable. The integral of 1 is theta. The integral of cosine 2 theta is essentially sine 2 theta. But then I realize I need a 1/2 out in front of that. Now if I differentiate it and use the chain rule, I'll get back to what I started with. So I know that's the correct antiderivative. And at this point, I can sub in the limits of integration and get my exact solution. But there's one more challenge left to overcome. Before I get to that, I'll sub in my lower limit. When you put in 0 for theta, you get 0. When you put in 0 for theta and sine 2 theta, you get another 0. So both of those contribute nothing. And that's really the payoff of doing what we did back here, saying we're just going to take twice the integral of half the area. That gave us that nice 0. Now, when I'm looking at the upper limit, plugging in for theta is not a big deal. That's fine. But plugging in for sine 2 theta, that's a problem because the sine of twice an inverse sine, I don't know how to deal with. But if I had like the sine of the inverse sine or the cosine of the inverse sine, I could deal with that. So I'm going to use another identity here. I'm going to use the identity for sine 2 theta. That's 2 times the sine times the cosine. And the 2 cancels the 1/2 and I end up with this. And I'm trying to sub in inverse sine root 5 over 3. And again, when I sub in the 0, I get 0, so I'm not worried about that. So plugging in for theta, that's inverse sine root 5 over 3. Then I get into this expression. So the sine of the inverse sine of root 5 over 3, that's just root 5 over 3. The one that's non-trivial is the cosine of the inverse sine. So I end up with the cosine of the inverse sine root 5 over 3, and that needs to be simplified. So how do I get a trig function of an inverse trig function? We use what's sometimes called a reference triangle. I'm going to use the symbol theta for the angle whose sine is root 5 over 3. That's what that inverse sine means. And sine is opposite of our hypotenuse, so here's one way to do it. Now the sine of this angle is root 5 over 3. What's the cosine of the angle whose sine is root 5 over 3? That requires that I find this horizontal leg. To figure this out, you use the Pythagorean theorem. Question mark squared plus root 5 squared, which is 5, is equal to 3 squared, which is 9. And question mark squared turns out to be 4, which means that leg is 2. Now I can find the cosine of the angle whose sine is root 5 over 3. It's just the adjacent over the hypotenuse, or 2/3. So things are starting to really come together now. I have 36 pi over root 5 inverse sine root 5 over 3 plus root 5 over 3 times the cosine of the angle whose sine is root 5 over 3. And I just figured out that's 2/3. So maybe the last thing I'll do here is rationalize the denominator. So I'm going to multiply the denominator out front by root 5. And that means I have to multiply the numerator by root 5 as well. But there's some advantage to distributing that root 5 into the interior of these parentheses. So let's see what that looks like. In the second piece, I just hit it with a root 5. So that becomes 5. 5 times 2 is 10. So I end up with 10/9 in there. Now that's clean enough to be a final answer. And hopefully we'll be able to see how to compare with the answer produced by a computer algebra system. So here I am in Maxima, and I went back to the step in the lower left-hand corner, and I put in 2 times the integral, so that's integrate in Maxima, 4 times percent pi, percent pi is the special symbol for pi, over 9 times the square root of 81 minus 5x squared. Integrate that as x goes from 0 to 3. Now, it can sometimes be a little tricky to find agreement between a computer algebra system and what you did by hand. One thing I notice in this solution is that there's a factor of 9 inside the parentheses in the numerator, and that would cancel with a factor of 9 in this denominator, giving me a 5 in the denominator. We might be able to get Maxima to simplify that for us. So I used the ratsimp command, and percent means the prior output. Ratsimp means simplify a rational expression. So it did indeed cancel the factor of 9 out of there. Now, if I look at the first term in the numerator, I see the inverse sine of root 5 over 3. That's what a sine is in maxima, times 36 pi times root 5, all divided by 5. So that term checks out. It's exactly the same as what we got by hand. The second term is a 40 pi over 5. So we're going to have to think about if we distributed that 36 pi over 5 to the 10 over 9, you could cancel the 9s, leaving you with 4 pi over 5 times 10. That's 40 pi over 5. And that agrees with maxima as well. So we've checked out our solution with the computer algebra system, and it agrees with what we did by hand. If you find the math content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce dozens of new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.